Yeah.
Thank you. Very happy to be here. This has been a lot of fun. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the boundary-to-bound dictionary that some of you have heard me talk about, and this Post-Minkowski effective filter approach to compute the scattering data that goes into the boundary-to-bound dictionary. This is work in collaboration with Gregor Kalin, who's going to give a talk, a follow-up talk this afternoon, Senwen Liu and Xixin Yang, who hopefully are in the audience. So very good. So let's get started. So what is the motivation? So our motivation was this beautiful set of papers, first by Cliff, Ira, and Michael, and then by the BCRSSC collaboration, who confronted with this problem to connect the scattering amplitude, the classical limit of the scattering amplitude, to compute observables, for example, for bound orbits. What they did was match the scattering amplitude to an effective theory that has a local potential interaction and compute the Hamiltonian. Now, this is a perfectly fine approach. The gravitational interaction is universal. You can put the system, once you know the Hamiltonian, you can study any situation that you want. But as Lanz would say, gauge invariant is good. It's good. Gauge dependent is bad. So from the point of view of the on-shell program, you might ask yourself, do we really need the Hamiltonian to connect information from a gauge invariant quantity, such as the scattering amplitude or the scattering angle, as we will see, to compute another gauge invariant quantity, for example, the periastrum advance? And as I will try to demonstrate to you in the on-shell spirit of connected gauge invariant information, the answer is no. We do not need the Hamiltonian. The information is already there. And I will tell you how to extract the information from the scattering amplitude and eventually from the scattering angle to compute observables for bound orbits, such as the periastrum advance or the binding energy, in what I like to call this boundary to bound dictionary. So I did not put here. Oh, no, it's good. I should have put here. This started in our paper, which is now a year old in collaboration with Gregor. I should have kept the reference there, but let me tell you what the map relies on. So what was our first idea? So the map relies on a very simple observation that was already sitting there in the paper by SV and collaborators. So even though they didn't write it this way, they noticed up to 3 p.m. order, and actually they even could show even to higher orders, that if you take the central mass momentum, not the Hamiltonian, but the momentum in the post-Minkowskian expansion, and you look at the coefficients, those are directly related to what I wrote down there, the Fourier transform of the scattering amplitude, the infrared final part of the classical limit of the scattering amplitude with this relativistic normalization, this factor of 1/2e. So what they show is that those two, not directly this way, but it's equivalent to this, those two are related and in fact they are equal. And this for us was the first, that is funny moment, this what I like to call this Asimov moment, because even though in their paper, this looked like a curiosity, which in fact they used to compute the scattering angle. For us, it was like, okay, there must be a reason for this, must be a deeper reason. And in fact, we should be able to show whether this is true to all orders. And this was the origin of what we like to call, or I like to call this impetus formula that was also mentioned in Julio's talk, which is a relationship between this, the momentum in the center of mass frame of the two-body problem directly to the infrared final part of the scattering amplitude. Now, I'm gonna talk about only about the conservative sector here. We think we understand how to extend this to the to include the radiation part. For sure, we know how to do the conservative part of the radiation. There are also this, that Michael also mentioned, these tail effects that I will tell you a little bit more in my talk. Those are a little tricky. So there's a non-local contribution that will modify this formula. So I'm not gonna talk about this here. So this formula applies for all the local contributions in the conservative sector and directly relate the two-body momentum to the scattering amplitude, to the infrared final part of the scattering amplitude. And now we're in business, because once we have this connection, which if you ask me, I'll tell you how to prove it. In fact, we can even use the ideas that have been used also by Julio and collaborators to relate the amplitude to the total impulse. You can adapt the same tools that Kosover, that David, Ben, and Donald also worked out for the impulse. You can do the same to compute the P square, and the same idea will also give you this connection. And once you have this impetus formula, you can directly use this P square to compute, for example, the scattering angle. So this is something that goes back to the 50s. I think it was 1953 when this guy first realized that you can invert the relationship between the scattering amplitude and the momentum, that I'll show you later, but there is an integral that relates the scattering angle to the momentum. So he found the inverse of that relationship. This is the first formula that relates the momentum. This is normalized by P infinity, by the momentum at infinity. That's what the bar means, to the scattering angle. If you now do a Post-Minkowskian expansion on both sides, you can directly relate the coefficients, the Post-Minkowskian coefficients of the scattering angle to the Post-Minkowskian coefficients of the center mass momentum. Those Fs are just the dimensionless versions of those P. This formula is just a combinatorial formula that you can ask Gregor later how that works, but this works to all order. And what does that mean? Since I can relate the Fs to the Ps, it's just a dimensional coefficient, then the Ps are related to the scattering amplitude to the impetus formula. I can directly relate the scattering angle to the coefficients of the scattering amplitude. And then I don't need to do any integral. I don't need to compute, for example, the zeros of the momentum to compute the distance of closest approach. This is a direct algebraic relationship that gives me a direct connection between the scattering amplitude to the scattering angle. This is very good, but we can do much more. We can now go into the bound problem. So how does this boundary to bound map works? Well, we're gonna recycle a very old idea that was, I think, first used by Sommerfeld to quantize the hydrogen atom, if you remember, which is this idea of the radial action, which is the integral of the moment of the radial momentum. This has been used in the post-Newtonian regime because you can solve for the momentum once you know the Hamiltonian. You know the Hamiltonian, you can set H equal to the energy and you can solve for P, P as a function of the energy, you plug it in here, you compute the radial action. But we're gonna do it in the post-Minkowskian regime through the impetus formula. So we're gonna solve for PR as a function of the amplitude. As you see there, I can use my mouse, sorry. We can use the impetus formula to solve for the radial action as a function, the radial momentum as a function of the amplitude. And what we do now is that since this is again universal, we can do an analytic continuation and say, okay, we computed the impetus formula for positive binding energy. We're gonna go now to negative binding energies to, for example, to compute observables for the binary case, for example, the periastrum advance, which is related, directly related to derivatives of this function. Now, if you take negative binding energies, then the motion occurs between the two zeros of PR. So this is an R minus and an R plus. And that integral you can do now directly by plugging this in the Post-Minkowskian expansion. I'm not gonna give you the expression because it looks ugly. Actually, Sommerfeld also find a way to do this integral in the complex plane by deforming the contour. So you actually don't need to know what R plus and R minus are. But you can do once you have the answer for this radial action directly in terms of the scattering amplitude is compute all the observables of the binary case. For example, you can compute the periastrum advance. And that's the expression. So to fourth post-Minkowskian order, because you know the periastrum advance is invariant and J goes to minus J and J here is the angular momentum or P phi. I'm not talking yet about spin. I will mention spin later. And all the motion occurs in a plane, I should have said. So we're right on that plane. So phi is the angle, the usual angle. So J P phi is the conserved angular momentum. And if you expand in 1/j, the periastrum advance invariant J goes to minus J, and therefore it goes like 1/j², 1/j², and so on. And if you go and look at the fourth post-Minkowskian order, the connection between the periastrum advance and the coefficient of the scattering amplitude is given by this expression. Now, the first correction here, the one loop correction, was already computed. It was in the beautiful paper by Simon and Sara. They didn't write it this way. Also, like it's B, they write it as the coefficient of the in momentum space of the 1/Q expansion and the self expansion. But if you realize it's really the wants to be a Fourier transform in a position space, then the coefficient is given precisely by this guy, which is the one loop Fourier transform of the amplitude. And this was in this paper by Simon. And then he also realized that if the triangle is zero, then there is no periastrum. But this generalizes this to all orders. So if you want to compute the next correction, which starts at four-point Minkowskian order, then not only the two loop enters, all the coefficients enter, including the three loop. And this, by the way, because Julio, Mao, and Michael found a non-zero contribution here, this strongly suggests that you're gonna have a non-zero periastrum here, even though, as I said at the beginning, I have not yet included any dissipative effect. So it's unclear whether this guy will be zero or not once we include those. But from the conservative sector alone and the local part of the conservative sector, it looks like we will have a periastron. So now I could continue with the scattering amplitude. But what we realize here is like, if we start with the scattering amplitude, which is a gauge invariant object, it's not truly the observable. What you would like to have perhaps is like, can I relate the scattering angle, which is something that I actually measure, and compute the radial action in terms of the scattering angle? Can I relate the periastron advance directly to the observable, which will be the scattering angle? So if you start doing that, and if you remember through the Filser formula, we know to all orders how to relate the scattering, the coefficients of the scattering angle to the coefficients of the momentum and through the impetus formula to the amplitude. And therefore we have, for example, the fourth point Minkowskian order is here. And then something remarkable happens. This is our second Asimov moment. If you look at the coefficient, and remember this is even in J, so you have to look at, for example, the chi 2, the chi 4, the chi 6, they are identical. You can show to all orders that the coefficients of the periastron advance and the even coefficients of the scattering angle are the same. And if you look at what they are, where do they come from? The scattering angle is the integral of the radial, of the derivative of the radial action with respect to J of the same object that we had before. The only difference is that in the unbound case, you have only one zero, which is the closest approach, and then you go to infinity. Whereas in the bound case, you have two zeros. You have r minus and r plus. Therefore, you're integrating the same thing, one with positive energy, one with negative energy, but between different points. So if you can relate the points, perhaps you can understand where this came from. And lo and behold, we had done that already. We had already shown that through analytic continuation in the angular momentum and the energy, not only in the energy, but also in the angular momentum, you can go from the unbound orbital elements to the bound orbital elements. And this is the connection that we found also through the Filser formula by analytic continuation in the impact parameter. I don't have time to explain this. Many of you have seen how this works. It's in our first paper. And why do we do this? Well, we do this because if you want to compute, say, the binding energy for a circular orbit, it's very easy to say, okay, the roots r plus and r minus are the same, and then you can solve for the energy as a function of j, and then you use the first law, the first law of binary dynamics, which is a derivative of the energy with respect to j, will give you omega, and then you solve for the energy as a function of omega directly to all orders in the PM expansion. So because we had this sitting here, then when we looked at this expression of the periastron advance and the scattering angle, we can just plug this in here. And if you loop around infinity, you find one of the most remarkable formulas that I ever seen. When I found this, I was extremely happy, because then you can see that you can directly relate now the scattering angle to the periastron advance to an analytic continuation, not only in the binding energy, but also in the angular momentum. And now this is a new ball game, because now I just completely remove any trace of the scattering amplitude. Now I just need to compute the scattering angle, but whichever means you want. And this now allows you to completely reconstruct the radial action in terms of the scattering angle. So what do we do? Well, if the derivative of the radial action with respect to J is the periastron advance, I just have to integrate. I just told you that the periastron advance is the angle. I integrate that relationship and I get the radial action. Obviously, only the even terms will contribute. You're gonna say something, Matt? No.
Well, you have 6 minutes.
6 minutes, oh shit. Okay, so, and then this coefficient can be fixed very easily by the large J limit. And this is our radial action. It just depends on the even coefficients of the scattering angle, and you just need to analytically continue to negative binding energies. You take derivatives and you get all observables. So this is the main message. This is the take home message. You give me the coefficients of the scattering angle to all past Minkowskian order. You analytically continue to negative binding energy. I construct now the radial action for the bound orbit, and through derivatives, I get all the observables. So now the question is, how are we gonna compute the scattering angle? And that takes me to this post Minkowskian approach. That was our third paper with Gregor, in which we say, okay, the scattering amplitude is great, but we have already an effective theory to compute the binding energy in post-Newtonian. Can we adapt those tools to the post-Minkowskian approach for the scattering angle? And this is what we did. So very quickly, you do the same. You integrate out the gravitational field. You do the saddle point. There's one interesting aspect about the scattering problem is that you can use the Polyakov action. So you don't have non-linearity couplings on the wall line, which is extremely It simplifies a lot the calculations. You can use the proper time that also have to simplifies a lot. You don't need to panic about Feynman. I mean, the double copy is beautiful. On-chain methods are great. But it's very easy now with new tools and computers and the reduction that we found by using total derivatives, gate fixing, and you can even use filter definitions if you want to include these couplings to reduce the complexity of the gravitational couplings. And Gregor is going to talk more about this. So we can go to higher orders with Feynman, and this is what we have done. So what do we compute? We compute the scattering angle. And what we do is just to solve the two body encounter by basically doing the Postman-Kosygin corrections on the straight lines, right? So you compute the deflection angle order by order in Postman-Kosygin in G, by essentially going and solving for the classical motion through the Euler-Lagrange equations. You plug it in the impulse. From the impulse, you get the angle. This is very straightforward and systematic. All you need to do now is to crank up, get an integrand, and do the freaking integrals. And to do the integrals, we're going to do what a lot of people have already mentioned. And this is also what we have done with NRGR, with normalized general relativity for the post-Newtonian case. There are two modes that contribute to this integrals. There are potential modes, there are radiation modes. The radiation modes also go into the conservative sector and the dissipative sector. To properly incorporate the dissipative sector, you need to retard the boundary conditions. You need to do an in-in calculation. So I'm not going to talk about that. Let me just very briefly tell you what we did in post-Newtonian. Why we do this? We do this because we simplify our lives tremendously. For example, we did the four loop calculation, the four post-Newtonian order dynamics in the conservative sector by simplifying those very complicated integrals and expanding in regions. So potentials are basically quasi-static three-dimensional massless integrals, which are much easier to compute. And here, because the radiation modes are long, you can match into a multiple expansion and compute in a theory with multiple moments. And then you realize that this screws the UV, this screws the IR, but the two will cancel each other and you have to be careful. You have to do the zero bin subtraction and so on. I'm not gonna talk about that because here we're gonna do Postman-Kosygin. So a lot of people have already mentioned that perhaps we can treat those two modes as ones. I do not really like this soft, but if we call soft anything that is not hard, then I'm happy because that includes the potential and radiation modes. And what we have heard already a lot in talks by Michael, Julio, Gabriele, and Carlo, and so on, is that we can solve the entire soft region through differential equations. And this is very nice because the integrals that we have are single scale. So there's just this gamma, this boost factor that we need to solve these equations on. And then the Q factors out, the momentum transfer factors out just on dimensional grounds. And then you just go ahead and have to compute these differential equations. You found the canonical form and so on. And what really matters is the boundary conditions. And as we heard also from Michael, from Carlo and so on, you can look for the boundary conditions in the entire soft region, or for example, up to two loops, you can just, because the real part is just on the potentials, you can just do the potential regions for the boundary condition. And here I'm advertising Gregor talk that's gonna tell you a little bit about the three loop calculation that we've been doing. And there's a lot of caveats here, how we're gonna incorporate this in the dictionary that I just told you about. If you ask me, I can tell you about that later. So because up to next to leading order, up to 3 p.m., the real part is purely potentials. So we just need the boundary conditions from the potentials. And we found a basis in which the boundary conditions are actually the same integrals that we have in post-Newtonian. So we could literally bootstrap the post-Newtonian answer into the post-Minkowskian regime. We only had 8 elements in the canonical basis. We knew how to do this integral. So it was very systematic. And then we computed the impulse to 3 p.m. order from which we get the scattering angle that agrees with the calculation of SPN company. So since I'm running out of time, I'm not gonna tell you much about this. Gregor will probably talk a little bit more. There are very few diagrams that we need to compute, only 5. These are 1-point functions that we can easily see. We can even fit these guys from the Schwarzschild limit. These guys don't even contribute. So the only one was the H that gave us the log of X, this sinh that came out of the differential equation. So this was very systematic, very straightforward. And let me emphasize, and Gregor will talk a little bit more about this, is that even though we have Feynman diagrams, one of the neat things about this approach is that we land directly in the self-expanded curve version of the integrand. We don't have these infrared superclassical divergences. And as I was trying to emphasize through the boundary to bound dictionary, we do the on-shell philosophy of directly relating the gauge invariant information in the scattering in the scattering angle to the information, for example, in the periastomal advance and all the observables for bound orbits. What is the main drawback is that we have Feynman diagrams. As I've been trying to say, Feynman still rocks, and we have just a few diagrams. The rules are simpler than the post-Newtonian case, and we are computing gauge invariant observables. So that simplifies our life tremendously. So you might ask now, if we're computing the 3PM, which is the chi3, and we needed the even terms in the boundary to bound dictionary, how are we gonna input the chi4 that we don't have? We have the 3PM, but we don't have the chi4, the 4PM. So what do I do when I go to this dictionary? Well, what we do here, if you remember, is that there is a relationship between the PNs, the P squared, the expansion of the P squared and the post-Minkowskian expansion with the chi's, with the angle that I told you before. And therefore you can just solve from chi3 for P3. And then you go to the chi4 and you realize that there is a P4 that you're missing, but when you do the analytic continuation, this chi scales with PN and it's subleading, this chi scales with PN and it's subleading, and this is all you need to keep up to the same post-Newtonian order. So there is a consistent truncation. Although this is really telling us we need the P4 to complete the chi4 and complete the 1 over J4 expansion to all orders in post-Newtonian of the radial action. So let me just flash the result. For example, the periastomal advance to two loop exactly agrees with the 2PM result as you expect, but because we have the exact one loop result of the 1 over J squared correction from the one loop amplitude, we get the 1 over J squared to all post-Newtonian orders. And this was checked. We basically, in our first paper, we made a prediction for 5PM that was confirmed, and it's even confirmed to 6PM just from here. And if we complete the 1 over J4 with the 3PM, with the 3 loop 4PM calculation, we will get the 1 over J4 to all orders. So we also computed all the other observables through derivatives without the Hamiltonian, and we also did the first spin. And since probably I'm running out of time, I'm gonna let somebody ask me about the new results that I was gonna say is that we have computed this now for a spin. We have extended the dictionary for a spin and we have gotten some new results. So I don't know how much time I have.
You have 3 minutes left, including the questions.
So I should stop or I have 3 minutes and then questions.
You should probably stop and ask for questions.
Okay, good. So let me just go here. So let me just summarize. So we found a lot of connections here between the scattering amplitude, the scattering angle, and observables from bound orbits through this object, this object that is the radial action that we constructed either through the impetus formula or through the integrating this relationship between the periastomal advance and the scattering angle that give us this representation. So it's a lot of beautiful relationships here. But what we really still don't understand, which will be very nice to understand, this is the expression that you get to all orders from the impetus formula. These are the infrared fine, the conservative sector so far, but the infrared finer part of the scattering amplitude. This is the radial action. I didn't show you this before because this is beautiful in terms of chi and we computed it through Feynman. But if you knew how to go directly from here to here, and Julio's been telling us that maybe he knows how to do that, and if he can do this to all orders, this would be amazing because then you can jump directly here and go straight to the observables. We are doing it this way, but perhaps you can even do it this way, okay? Of course, you can compute the angle through the scattering amplitude, and that you can also go this way, but there's a lot of connections here that are hinting perhaps at a deeper structure. And what I want to say too is that this post-Minkowskian effective filtering approach seems to be very efficient. It was very efficient for us to do post-Newtonian, and it seems to be very efficient for us to be in post-Minkowskian. As you have from Gregor, we are advancing to 4PM, and it seems to be that we are yet to reach a wall. So we seem to be progressing, and perhaps even the 5PM is not impossible or unthinkable. So I should probably stop here. Thank you very much, and I'm up for questions.
All right, let's thank Raphael. And any quick questions?
Nobody's gonna ask me about spin. Chashen and of course Chashen was gonna ask me.
Yes, indeed. please.
Eh?
Yeah, go for it.